Start now?
Yeah, just start talking. I mean, all right. And then make sure you address yourself, like who you
are. Of course, of course.
All right.
Hello, my name is Ian Browne. I am a former opiate addict, drug addict extraordinaire, really. I've done it all. Hardcore IV user. I was born in Lowell, Massachusetts, which is the epicenter to crack cocaine and all that during the 90s. I was born in a family that was very basic, blue-collar family. My father, Peter, my mother, Brenda. She was a homemaker. My father was a machinist. I have an older brother, Matthew. He died of a drug overdose, but that's later. throughout my life, things were real crazy. At first, everything was okay, though. When I lived in Lowell, when I lived in Massachusetts, in Boston, outside of Boston. And as soon as we moved to Florida, everything just kind of went to shit. My parents, they drank a lot, a lot. And my father ended up putting my hands on my mother, things like that. And they got a divorce. As soon as they divorced, it was just my brother and I and my mother. My father moved into some crap hotel. He liked to frequent strip clubs and drank booze, and he was a severe alcoholic. And he likes strippers and coke. So I had a good relationship with my father, besides all that, and my mother. So let's skip ahead here a little bit. My father ended up, you know, moving back to Boston. And my mother, my brother, and I were left in this house in Palm Harbor in the suburbs. But she's never worked a day in her life. She was a homemaker before. So she started bartending. And you know how the restaurant business is. You know, people are on drugs, things like that. And my mother ended up dating a guy who was only 25 years old when I was a kid. I was probably 7 or 8. And it was just, my brother and I didn't like it one bit. She partied her ass off. My father went further and further into alcoholism. Things got real bad. I remember one time when my father found out my mother was dating somebody else who was only 25. We were all hanging out at his house. It was the weekend visit, so I was at my father's. And he gets his buddy Gary. He's all shit-faced and drunk. And my brother and I, we caused a little bit of shit. We said, hey, we don't like this guy. So my father gets Gary. He says, Gary, get in the fucking car. You're driving. Drive down there. Drive down to my mother's house, the house I lived in also. He pulls right up in the fucking front yard. My father jumps in, kicks the fucking door in. Boom. Puts a big old hole in the wall. All that. And my mother's boyfriend, guy was overweight too. It's hilarious. He was in the shower at the time. The guy squeezed through a window about this big. And his fat ass ran butt naked down the street. That was a day in the life of my childhood. And to me, smoking cigarettes, drinking alcohol, things like that were normal. to me, I didn't think there was anything wrong with it. Everybody else did it. So, as time passed, my mother dated all these shitheads, mostly drug dealers. I remember one of them, we went down to a 4th of July party, and he passed out, the owner of the home, passed out these big paper bags full of fireworks, full of them. I mean, packed full. He gave it to every single person that came to that party. And they had a bunch of land and a little pond. And they shot off, I mean, it had to have been thousands and thousands of dollars for the fireworks. And then they also gave out big old bags of weed to everybody. Every single picnic table had a big old sack of weed. And to me, that was my first time ever seeing something like that. You know, like large drug dealers or a bunch of drugs and people having a good time. And to me, I was like, well, there's nothing wrong with this. Everybody else is having a good time. These people have a beautiful house, nice property, can throw this huge party. So to me, I looked up to these kind of people. So did my brother. So a few years later, we'll cut a few years later, and my mother's new boyfriend was this Coast Guard pilot. She was trying to do something like, you know, I don't know, trying to make it seem like a real family. That never worked. When I was in school, I was in elementary school. I caused a lot of trouble in elementary school, getting referrals, stuff like that. And then in middle school, my first week, I was taught how to steal cigarettes from the Circle K up the street. So I started stealing cigarettes, started smoking cigarettes. Then a buddy of mine had some pot. In that same week, I was already smoking pot. And then I used to skateboard to school. And I'd skateboard there extra early. I'd meet at my buddy Chris's house. And we'd have screwdrivers. We'd be drinking. I mean, I'm talking 12 years old. To us, it seemed okay. To me, it seemed okay. Because that's what my family did. So through school, I caused tons of trouble. Tons. I picked on kids so bad, I put a kid in a garbage can, threw him down the stairs. His name is Mike Nerad. Never forget it. And another kid named Nick. I'm not going to say his last name. I don't want to, you know, do all that. But we picked on him so bad that to the point that he left school. Went to another school. I did that to four separate kids. I was angry. I was always so angry. Because my mother was never home. She was a bartender. All we did was party at the house when she wasn't there. Because she was never there. I remember one time where our house was in foreclosure. Because we were in the suburbs. And we had this house with a nice pool. And our dryer broke. So our washer. I used to have to dry my clothes out on the pool and I wash my clothes in a sink. Irish Spring soap can take out just about any stain. So school is rough because I was going to school in a place where everybody was rich. There were the haves. I was one of the have-nots. And being a have-not is rough. not being able to, you know, have all the snacks that your friends have, you know, more than three outfits, you know. And my brother and I, we decided, fuck that. We're smart. We're going to outsmart the man. So we started pirating movies, stealing from the actual Warner, like Warner Brothers sent us a cease and desist letter, or they would call the FBI, because we were making the DVDs, putting the labels on them, in the case, the actual ones that were going to be released, they were identical, except 6 months before they were released. So we sold those, and we also made fake IDs. The fake IDs were easy. All you have to do is take that PVC card, you sand it down. We sanded down everything except the signature. Now, hold on a second. Let me grab an ID so I can explain. You have a regular ID. Okay. This is before they had the extra pictures, but pretty much they're the same. And they have the same line at the bottom and the top. So what we did is we sanded down everything except the face and the signature. So we sanded down everything. We'd sell them for $50 a piece. And we used contact paper. Contact paper is this very clear sheet. You can get it at Office Depot. And then when you find the right font size for the ID, we would actually, you would just use water, attach the font size and everything that you typed out to fill up the ID. We changed the names and everything. Like on my ID, it was Ian John Connery. Like we made jokes out of it and everything. We made funny names. So you put that on there, and all you had to do was take a piece of 3M tape and a squeegee, squeegee it over. Then we'd take large magnets from stereo speakers, because back then that was a big thing, you know, big bass and everything. So what we did is we'd use those, and you put it against a magnetic strip, so it doesn't work. So it's all the person's discretion. At the store, the club, when they put it up to a black light, still looked good. So we did that for a while. Also, the drug use started getting worse and worse. Started doing coke, smoking a lot of weed. I started selling a lot of pot, a lot of acid. By then I dropped out of school for assaulting a teacher. Well, they gave me an ultimatum. They said, either we arrest you for assault or you drop out. So I dropped out. So I have a job at Dunkin' Donuts. And my buddy Pat was making sheets of acid. Only $100 a sheet. So at Dunkin' Donuts, I also had a weed connection where I was getting ounces of weed for like $40 a piece. And back then, that was a good thing. That was cheap. So I would, at Dunkin' Donuts, they'd call. I'd be like, Palm Harbor Dunkin' Donuts, this is Ian. They'd be a friend of mine. And I'd bring out a dozen donuts with a sack of weed and a strip of acid or however much they wanted. I did that for a few years. Quite a few years. I sold weed after that for a long time. Got it from a guy named Ox. I would sell a pound a week. But remember also, I was only about 18. So I kept selling. Kept sticking all the money underneath my mattress. I had so much money underneath my mattress. If you lifted it up and dropped it, money would shoot out everywhere. Meanwhile, my mother's dead broke. Couldn't even afford food. I really wish I would have helped her. But I was young. I didn't know. I was just being stupid, I guess. Thinking back, I wish I would have told her, hey, Mom, don't worry. There's a mattress full of fucking money. But I didn't. I'll regret that the rest of my life. So, after all that, around age, after I assaulted my teacher in high school, and I got kicked out, I ended up getting into painkillers. Vicodin, Percocets, Oxycodone, Oxycontin. And I kept meeting people that they had these, but they couldn't get rid of them. So I could trade them a little bit of pot, and they give me a big old sack full of pills that they stole from their mother or their grandfather or whatever. So I was doing a lot of them, shooting them up. But first time I shot up, I was 17. So I was an IV drug user at 17. I contracted hepatitis C around 17, 18 years old. I was cured of it just this last August. So, as things went on, I got more into the pill game. Because the news started telling people how much those pills are worth. Those pills in your medicine cabinet are worth a ton of money. So these grandparents, parents, uncles, aunts, whatever, were recruiting their children, their families, to sell them on the street because they didn't know anybody, you know what I mean? So I'd buy them up, trade for pot, buy them up, and I'd sell a bunch of them. I'd go to take trips to West Palm Beach and sell them there also, and then buy them also there too. Because they were only $10 a pill, so I could buy them there, bring them back here, sell them for $35, $40. Now, doing that worked. You know, it paid for my habit. You know, and people weren't dropping like flies back then. There was no fentanyl, there was none of that. So the guy I was buying all these pills from and everything was my best friend's father. He ran car dealerships, very successful man. That's when I started shooting up coke. All along with the pills. Speedballing. 17, 18 years old. But I thought, this guy's successful. Why can't I do it too? He does the same thing. Shoots up all that coke, all those pills. I could live a life just like him. Why not? He's successful. So as the years went on, I recruited a lot of people. And they would give me their prescriptions and I would sell them. Then, as greedy as I was, I decided there's a better way. So we got a doctor's information, Dr. Alexis Henderson, a pain management doctor out of Clearwater, Florida. What we did was stole her DEA number. Well, it didn't steal it, it's on the pad. The DEA number, license number, learned how to write scripts like per mouth, you know, three pills per mouth by day, blah, 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 and did it with a doctor's pen that we paid like $200 for. And we made the pads from scratch. We measured them out completely, had the font match the exact same size as her prescription pad. Then we acquired identification cards from strippers, young girls, all women, drug addicts. Once I'd give them a couple of pills and they'd give me their ID. Said if anybody asked, somebody stole it. So we had, before I got arrested, we had 9 identities that we used, women's identities. So we'd write these prescriptions, because now we had it down to a science. It looked exactly like Alexis Henderson's pain management clinic's prescription pad. So we had our own pad that we made and 9 identities that we could use to fill it. So 9 prescriptions at CVS, 9 prescriptions at Walgreens, 9 prescriptions at Target, and so on and so forth. And I was the one who would go in and fill said prescription. I'd act like the woman on the ID was my girlfriend. And we usually show up at 5 o'clock because when they call to verify the prescription, it's all pharmacist discretion because at 5 o'clock the doctor's office is closed. So it's all about pharmacist discretion. So I always made sure I went in there clean cut, no track marks, no nothing. Took care of myself very well. Also had a job as an electrician, so I looked like a hardworking man. So they never questioned me. I filled, God, I don't even know how many. But according to the newspaper article in the news, they said 16 phony prescriptions. And it's beyond that. It's probably more like 50 or 60 at least. So, the partner I was filling it with, there's 4 of us. 2 of them that got arrested really had nothing to do with it. One of them is now dead. That's Megan Walters. Christina Fortune filled a prescription about 4 or 5 o'clock and got busted. And those are the rules. We never did that. But I was at work that day, and my partner just got so desperate. Drug addiction makes people do things. Like, you can tell them you're about to get arrested if you feel that, but they'll still do it just because they're so dope sick. It's a horrible disease. A disease I've had for years. So she gets arrested for doing it too early, before 5 o'clock. My partner doesn't tell me. So we go to fill a prescription at the Target Pharmacy in Boot Ranch in East Lake, Florida. Usually what we do is I'll walk in, I'll give the ID. Not my ID, but the ID. I'll tell them I don't have my ID on me. Tell them I'm paying cash, no insurance. So what I do is after I give it to them and they say, okay, it'll be done later. I say, no, I'm going to have to wait because I have a far drive. So what I do is I sit outside and I watch all the doors, make sure no cops or anything like that show up. No cops did this day. So I go inside, thinking everything's clear. The doctor fills the prescription, but I could tell he looked a little shaky. Something didn't seem right. So he fills the prescription, hands it to me. And for some reason, I'm walking out. I'm in a Target, at the pharmacy. So I'm walking all the way down to the entrance. And I'm shaking the pills in it. I just had this feeling, something wasn't right. Opened it up, opened up the pill bottle, little blue pills. They should have been oxycodone, 30 milligrams. Look like them, I just closed it, kept walking. Turns out they were Claritin. I found that out much later. So as I walk out the door, apparently all the shoppers that were around me inside of the Target were actually part of the Delta Narcotics Force for Pinellas County. They were all undercover. I came outside, there's a helicopter in the air. I mean, cops fucking everywhere. All in unmarked cars, plain dress clothes. All of a sudden, I get pistol whipped and thrown in the bed of my pickup truck. And then they yell, oh, we got him too, we got Trent too. Oh, look at this, yeah, blah. And they play it off like he wasn't part of it. It was a setup. Then also, in my glove box, he had a bunch of prescriptions filled out, which we never do. We only bring the one that we fill, and that's it. We don't carry extra. So he had them loaded up in my glove box. He was setting me up. I go to jail. My bond was $120,000. Only had three charges. It was trafficking, then obtaining controlled substance by fraud, and unauthorized possession of a driver's license or ID. So, while I'm in jail, I keep going to new court dates, and more charges come. My bond in the beginning was only $120,000. It then raised to $262,000. Then eventually raised up to $286,000. My charges went from 3 to 12. I had 6 counts of a first-degree level 8 felony. Conspiracy, 3 counts of conspiracy, 3 counts of trafficking. 4 counts of obtaining controlled substance by fraud, and 2 counts of unauthorized possession of a driver's license. So looking at pretty much life. So I'm in jail, and the one that I was involved with, who I know set me up, he gets out of jail within about a month. And then I find out that he was the one who set me up. Because what he did was he didn't want to wait for me, you know, because I was his partner, to fill these prescriptions. He sent in some just random dumb girl, some junkie. She went in, got busted, sang an a cappella, 4-disc album. I mean, sang. I didn't know about it. So that's before that bust. That's how I got busted. Because I had no idea. He hid it from me. He set me up. I've known since I was 10 years old. I've never seen the man since. So while I'm in jail, I have these 12 felonies, 6 of them first degree level 8, minimum mandatory sentencing, 3 to 15 years on each count. I'm looking at life. I figure my life is over. So then all of a sudden, a detective comes in. It was a armed robbery, grand theft detective or whatever. And they try to give me 5 more felonies for the IDs, the identifications. Well, they didn't realize that on one of them, the girl was only 20 years old, and they said it was stolen from a club that's only 21 and up. And as soon as I pointed that out, they realized that it was all crap. So luckily, those 5 charges didn't stick. So now I went back down to 12. By the time I was formally charged, I got charged with 2 counts of attempted trafficking, 4 counts of obtaining controlled substance by fraud, and 2 counts of unauthorized possession of a driver's license. They had me interviewed by a man named Phil Chapman, because my choice was prison, period. Black and white. It was, you're doing prison. They can run it all concurrent. It was my first big arrest, my first arrest really, period. And besides my childhood misdemeanor arrest for possession of alcohol and stuff like that. But, you know what I mean? That's juvenile. They only care about your adult charges. So this guy interviews me and he tries to figure out, because he didn't catch me with any drugs. I never got caught with a single pill, but yet I'm being charged for these pills. And he interviews me to try to find out if I'm a drug addict or a drug dealer. Of course, I played the drug addict part the best I could, which ended up working out. My partner was long gone. I still, to this day, have not seen him. I don't know where he went. I don't know if he's alive or dead. I don't know. But he disappeared. So it's very obvious that he definitely set me up. And his girlfriend just recently overdosed. She's gone now, too. She's dead. I gotta pause for a second here, I'm sorry. I've just lost so many people to this epidemic. It's ridiculous. I sold so many drugs. I've seen women sell themselves, young girls, all for a little bit of dope, living in hotel rooms. I even pimped a few women. I'm not proud of that, but I didn't make them do it. They were willing to do it. By the way, after I got sentenced, I got extremely lucky. An attorney took me pro bono because he saw me on the news and he saw me in the newspaper. And that and the opioid epidemic was just really getting big. So he took my case. I got a deal. I had to agree to testify against all of my co-defendants, except all of my co-defendants already pled out. So it was really just had to be something on paper so they could sentence me underneath the guidelines. I did 180 something days in the county. Then I did 6.5 months in a rehab type facility, which is really worse than jail. And then I had 5 years of drug offender probation, which you got to call for your color every day. Yeah, I mean, you couldn't do fucking anything, man. It was absolutely insane. I can't believe I even passed it. And I also had 6 months of community control, which is house arrest. Since then, I've done all right. My brother passed away. He was living on the streets. He died. So I relapsed and I got into meth. Started selling meth. Well, I was buying meth, giving it to somebody to sell for me. Because of my charges, I didn't want to be caught. I remember one time, we went down to Arcadia to pick up 9 ounces, a 9-piece, quarter key of meth. And we're in this little trailer. Fucking place, scary as fuck. Meth dealers are fucking scary. They all carry guns and they don't trust anybody and they're paranoid as shit. So I'm in this trailer and and in this little tiny trailer, all there is 3 flat screen TVs with surveillance cameras. And I look at the surveillance camera and I see a woman butt naked. I'm in the middle of Arcadia, in the middle of the woods. All there is a trailer in this piece of property, and another trailer. That's it. I mean, you couldn't even, you could see the stars. I mean, we're far from the city. It was horrible. And I'm in this trailer, and the woman makes me do a hot rail, which is you use a torch and use a glass tube and you snort up, and what it does is it burns and melts and then blows in the smoke. And it was probably like a gram long. One made me do it because they're all paranoid, thinking maybe I'm a cop or something. They're nuts. But either way, I see in the surveillance camera this woman butt naked running back and forth in the middle of pitch black. We get the 9 ounces. We go to leave. My wallet's missing. I guess the naked woman took it. And we left. That was crazy. Meth dealers are by far the scariest people I've ever met. But since my arrest and my brother's death, I've quit that life. My little cousin died, 21. My brother died at 35. My father died of esophageal cancer from alcohol. Everybody I know and love is dead because of this opioid epidemic that I profited so much from. Sometimes I wonder, am I responsible for those people that died? The people I sold drugs to that died? People say no, but a part of me says yes. All I know is now I'm just a 38-year-old man on methadone, which I've been on since I was like 20. Live with my mother, have a good job, but I have to stay with my mother because ever since my brother died, she lost it. She's not the same. A mother can't bury her child. But everything I did so I could get ahead. I didn't have a rich family member. When I was 16, I couldn't even get my license because I got arrested so many times as a juvenile. I couldn't even get it till I was 18. I never had anything handed to me. So I had to make it myself. Unfortunately, I chose that path. And I beat myself up every day. I just hope this story reaches out to somebody. So I can realize that not worth it. You'll never get away with it. You always ended up getting caught. There is no great story about how you get away with it and you make all this money and no, it never ends. It never ends. The hustle never ends. You stay addicted to the hustle and it never ends. I'm living proof. It's amazing I'm even alive. All the other people I know that are dead, They shouldn't be dead. I should be dead. That's all I have.